Sir, I'm really sorry it's late, but I've managed to complete the homework for you.
Late again, Matthew?
Well, what do you mean?
Well, it's a regular occurrence. It happens quite often, actually. You always have an excuse.
Oh, I'll tell you what, just leave it then!
Wait, stop!
When people behave like this, how do we respond? By shouting them down, giving the message that the one with the loudest voice comes out on top, or by punishing them, or by concentrating solely on what has happened and ignoring the reasons why it has happened? Or is there a better way, one which doesn't merely ask who is to blame and what should the punishment be, but one which explores causes, feelings, effects? One which asks rather different questions, such as, what happened? Who has been affected? What harm has been caused? And crucially, how can we put things right? One that involves listening, not telling. A way that is better, not just for those who have been harmed, but also for those who have caused harm.
I can, like, get my point of view across without, like, getting... argue, like being in an argument.
We all understood how we all felt.
And which aims to stop it happening again, a way that means a line can be drawn under the incident and everyone can move on.
It's enabled us to, for staff, I think, to feel heard and to actually feel that problems are resolved rather than just punished.
A way that works.
It's much more positive.
It isn't seen as a soft option. It's actually seen as something that is successful and it will help us all.
Some of the ideas behind a restorative approach have been around for some years. For example, reconciliation between offenders and victims was first tried in Canada back in 1975. This approach proved to be so successful that it led to other victim-offender projects in Canada and the United States. And in the next few years, victim-offender mediation was tried in some European countries with encouraging results. Another element of a restorative approach is restorative conferencing, bringing together those directly involved in an incident with people who've been affected by it, in the company of their family members or people from the community. This approach has its roots in New Zealand. Maoris believe that when someone commits an offence, it impacts on the family and the wider community. They also believe that the whole community must be accountable for what has happened and be involved in finding a way forward. Since then, many schools throughout the country, infant, primary, secondary, special schools and pupil referral units, have benefited from adopting a restorative approach.
When I read the material about restorative approaches, I realised that it was something that really fitted with my own personal ethos and my beliefs. And I knew through my own experiences of conflict and resolving problems in my own life that it was certainly something that I could see would really empower children and staff. Over the years, we've then trained every year, we've trained at least 3 members of staff. And we're very blessed that those staff have stayed at the school. And so those experiences are shared through inset, through day-to-day experience. You think it's going to be time-consuming, but actually the time-consuming side of things was, in the past, was the more negative approaches to managing conflict or exclusions or detentions. They take up far much more time than actually taking the time to resolve a problem. It's meant that we've been able to free up people's time to concentrate on learning. My school is in a very challenging setting. There are children with a high percentage of children with special needs, children with difficulties with managing their behaviour. Despite the challenges we may have faced implementing it, without a doubt, you can see the difference it's made to the community.
So what does the restorative approach consist of? Well, there are 5 key themes. When something has happened, everyone will have their own perspective on it. And if they are to feel respected and valued, they should have the opportunity to talk about their experiences and what happened. We should listen to everyone involved and hear their unique stories, avoiding the temptation to interrupt, to take sides, to assume we know what has happened, to offer advice or solutions. It's important to fully understand what people were thinking when an incident occurred, because their thoughts would have influenced their feelings, which in turn would influence their behaviour. So we need to find out what was going on inside their head. Conflicts or disagreements often cause emotional harm to someone. They may be left feeling angry, hurt, afraid, frustrated, or confused. Relationships may have been damaged. We need to consider what harm has been caused and how people have been affected. What are the needs of both parties in a conflict? They will both have them, and their needs may be quite similar. But until those needs are identified and shared, it's difficult to decide on appropriate strategies to repair the harm and rebuild relationships. How can a conflict be resolved? How can things be put right? How can everyone move on? The people who are best placed to provide the answers are the people involved. Having shared what they all need, people can then be invited to work together to identify strategies that will meet those needs, coming up with a way forward that will satisfy everyone. Their conflict, their decisions, their solution, and the fact that they've been trusted to provide it can really benefit everyone concerned. Five themes for a restorative approach to conflict, introduced one by one until they become second nature, and a whole new way of dealing with conflicts is achieved, one that emphasizes trust, tolerance, and mutual respect, and recognizes the importance of people's feelings and their needs. The whole restorative approach is based on the firm foundation of strong relationships and pro-social connections. In classrooms and in the staff room, people get used to meeting in circles to identify what everyone needs from each other to give of their best, for example, or to check in of a morning. Maybe to review what happened in a previous lesson, either in terms of the learning or unresolved issues that may have arisen. Putting the restorative approach into practice requires everyone in the school using certain skills every day. The ability to show empathy and really listen to people. Acting impartially and not being judgmental. Respecting everybody's point of view. Enabling the people involved in a conflict to come up with their own solutions, being compassionate, showing warmth, and having lots of patience. Using the day-to-day skills in more formal situations ensures that even when harm has happened and emotions run high, all staff are modeling what they teach. This can transform the whole atmosphere of a school, as many have found. There are a whole variety of elements involved in a restorative approach, and some of them may already be in place in schools. There will probably be a school council. There may well be a peer mentoring scheme, playground buddies or something similar.
They love doing circle time. I think it's a nice time to bring the class together, especially if there are things that have happened in the day, it's things you can get together, you can talk about it and sort out things that are happening in the playground or outside of school that people are both happy and possibly not happy with. And also, it's a nice opportunity to play games as a class together and really sort of swap around and share a lot of fun with each other.
Iffley Mead School have been using restorative approaches for approximately 7 years now. The head teacher, Kay Willett, and I came to the school in 2002-2003. The school was a failing school at the time. Half of the staff had left, and in fact, any new initiative was welcome, anything to try to improve the standard of the school. We're using the SEAL initiative to support the restorative approach because they work very well together. And now all of the pastoral support workers in the school deliver SEAL circles to all our key Stage 3 classes throughout the school.
We use the SEAL approach, which is the social and emotional aspects of learning. And what we do with the students is bring them into the circle where they're together. We build on their self-esteem and confidence, make them feel comfortable in speaking out loudly. Whereas in a table and desk setting, they probably wouldn't talk at all.
Starting off with the circle time, it helps bring them together as a team, as a group, which is what we try to sort of emphasise around the school, is that your class group is your class team.
In terms of Every Child Matters, I mean,
the one thing it does above anything else when you're using a restorative approach is it enables people to feel safe. And that's one of the, you know, key outcomes, and everyone wants that for their child.
I'm glad you've all agreed to come, and we know why we're here, don't we? We're going to focus on the environment in the classroom and see if we can take it from where it is now and look and see how we can make it a more positive and enjoyable classroom. To do this, we're going to look at your needs, we're going to look at Sir's needs, and we're going to look at everyone's needs as well.
Boys, let me just stop you there for a moment, please. What's happening?
What I'd like to do first is to come to you, Stephen, and ask you to help us understand the harm that's been caused. Talk a little bit about what happened.
What were you thinking when she got you out?
Mum's love, why did she get me out? I'm her best friend.
What are you thinking about right now?
I'm just, thinking, that if she, she doesn't stop it, it'll be hard to make friends again.
Kane, how are you feeling?
A bit upset.
So how were you feeling then at the beginning of PE?
When things get boisterous, I feel sad, just in case anyone gets hurt. I think it affects everyone.
Now, do you think anyone's been affected in this?
Who do you think affected, Jamie?
And I just wondered if you wanted to just tell me who you feel's been affected.
That's what you need to happen now.
What do you think you need, Kurt, then?
What do you need, Alia, that will help you?
Hey, Matt, what do you need to put this right?
What do you think you need to do to sort of repair the harm?
Can you tell me what you need to happen from this, Samantha, to put it right?
By using these various processes, a school can deal effectively with a wide variety of situations. Many can be dealt with on the spot, with restorative inquiry and discussion being used to resolve a conflict. Some situations may be a little more complex and require a face-to-face meeting between the parties involved. And some, the more serious ones, may require a family conference.
Restorative approaches helps reduce exclusions at Deptford Green because it breaks down the barriers between the students and the teachers and helps them have an understanding of the situation and how it makes each other feel. Also, by humanising the teacher to the student, they stop becoming it and become a he or a she.
When a school adopts a restorative approach, it's important that everyone takes it on board. Support staff as well as teachers, all the pupils, parents, school governors.
I like when we talk about our feelings.
For me as well, I learned a lot from him and from the school, from everybody, because I give him the chance now, I give him the time to explain himself, and I could see the improvement.
It's quite surprising, actually, how often it does sort things out really quickly, and it's often with the children who you least expect it to work with.
There should be a whole school involvement to a restorative approach, because it is the whole school that is affected by it. Some mindsets may need to be changed, but when it's done properly and becomes part of the everyday life of the school, the restorative approach can make schools safer, happier places, reduce exclusions and the need for them, create a culture of belonging, raise morale and self-esteem, have a real impact on bullying, raise attendance, and reduce staff turnover and burnout. It's not always easy at first, but it's well worth persevering.
I think in the early years when we first implemented restorative approaches, probably there were the biggest challenges were from more established members of staff. Staff that I'd worked in special education and were used to doing things to children rather than with children.
It's only really the parents that we've had to bring in, because there have been behavioural issues that we've had to work with restoratively with. And although to them it's quite different from many, the way that many of them would deal with the child themselves, they can see the benefits of it. And so by just working with them on a very informal basis, I feel that they believe in it now. They understand that this is perhaps something that will work with their child, whereas other perhaps firmer sanctions have failed.
If you can be brave enough to give children and adults, but even more so children, the space to really explain what their needs are and their feelings are. And if you can create an atmosphere where the staff feel safe to do that as well, it is incredible how far the children can move, not just in their emotional well-being, but in their academic work. And I'm very proud of what my staff and children here have achieved.
When this becomes this, everyone benefits. Restorative approaches transform conflict, transform attitudes, transform behaviour and relationships, transform the whole school environment.